Good morning. Good morning, and a happy Easter to you all. We are delighted to see you on this Easter Sunday, and we extend a greeting to those who are joining us by live stream. And I'm going to invite you to respond to a very traditional Easter greeting. When I say Christ is risen, you say He is risen indeed, okay? Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay, a little stronger. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
One more time. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen and amen. I have just a couple of quick announcements. Next Sunday, we're going to have a congregational meeting as part of our worship service in order to elect John Robert Cockrell as an elder emeritus, honoring him for over 50 years of service in this congregation. What a joy, what a privilege. And so that'll be part of our worship service next Sunday. And then next Sunday evening, we'll continue in our series with Andrew Brunson. His topics are going to be building perseverance and avoiding deception. Wow, very timely messages for our day and time. This Thursday, the historical highlight luncheon will feature yours truly. Only reason being, I am the last and the least on a long line of pastors that have served this church. And so it's my privilege to talk about them. And so we're going to be talking about the pastors ever since 1849 when this church was begun. That should be interesting. A reminder that there is a town hall meeting on April the 18th, an opportunity to meet the candidates, some of the candidates that are running for office in our county. And so everyone that lives in French Camp or in Choctaw County, you're welcome to come and be informed about upcoming elections. We have been and will continue to be in prayer for Lance Ragsdale and his family and the death of his mom, Willie Dozier, who passed away this week. And let's lift them up, particularly tomorrow, as the funeral service will be held in Meridian. And the details are on the back of your bulletin. Now, if you have glanced at your bulletin already, I would encourage you to do so. And you will notice immediately that our service today is going to be different. We are going to devote ourselves to the Word of God, and we're going to hear read much of the story of the trial and crucifixion of Jesus Christ. We will not have all the text on the screen. Most of the readings will come out of Luke chapter 23 and 24. You're welcome to open your own Bible and follow along. Or, and I would encourage this, just relax and listen. Pay close attention and be active listeners as you hear the story. The other thing that we are going to do that's a little different today, we're going to sing a lot. And I want you to put yourself into these selections. Not everybody's a great tenor or whatever, but that's okay. You make a joyful noise. And if you don't know the particular hymn, pay close attention to the words, because these hymns are designed to not only reflect what's being told in the story, but to give you an opportunity to respond in worship. Singing is worship. And as you hear even the words and appreciate their meaning coming out of your own mouth singing, you are engaged in worship. And we just trust that this blend of listening and participating will lead us to a very meaningful participation in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, which will come towards the end of our service today. So let's, at this time, take a few moments and prepare our hearts. to begin our worship on this Easter Sunday. Amen. Amen to that. From Isaiah 53, "Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied." Let's pray together. Dear Father in heaven, as we gather for worship on this high moment in the calendar year of the church, as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord, we come to you and bow with awe as we realize that your death and crucifixion was not a plan B. It was not a solution to something unforeseen. It was your intent from before the ages. It was your plan of redemption laid down in your mind before the world began. We bow humbly at such mysteries that are too great for us to understand. And we bow with gratitude that love so deep and so wide and so great would cause our Father in heaven to send his only Son to shed his blood on a cross. But there in the grave, he conquered death, and he rose again that he might live and reign for all eternity. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that by trusting in you, we too have new life. We too have eternal life. And so as we gather today, as we come to worship, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would make our minds keen, make our hearts responsive, make our wills yielded, that you might have your way in our midst here this morning, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue our worship with a responsive reading, and you may take a hymnal to and open it to number 379, or the words will be up here over my head. And I'm going to invite you to pay close attention, because some of the readings are mine, the leader. Other ones are for the men, some are for the women, and some of them are for everyone. So pay close attention as we read God's word here responsively. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. The righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. In him we have redemption through his blood and forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. My faith and hope are in God. Amen.
Let's stand and lift our voices together as we sing, "I Will Sing of My Redeemer."
I Reading, if you're following in your Bible, from Luke 23. Then the whole company of them arose and brought him before Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man misleading our nation and forbidding us to give tribute to Caesar, and saying that he himself is Christ, a king." And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You have said so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no guilt in this man." But they were urgent, saying, "He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea from Galilee even to this place." And then if you're looking in your Bible, skip to verse 13. Pilate then called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was misleading the people. And after examining him before you, behold, I did not find this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither did Herod, for he sent him back to us. Look, nothing deserving death has been done by him. I will therefore punish and release him." But they all cried out together, "Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas," a man who had been thrown into prison for an insurrection started in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them once more, desiring to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify! Crucify him!" A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no guilt deserving death. I will therefore punish and release him." But they were urgent, demanding with loud cries that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate decided that their demand should be granted, and he released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, for whom they asked, but he delivered Jesus over to their will. And as they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus.
Morning outside that was traveling the trace and just stopped in for worship. There are a lot of visitors today. Matter of fact, there's probably more visitors than there are regulars in here today. And that's good. That's the way the body of Christ should be. So we're glad that you came. Let's go to the Lord. Lord Jesus, we come to you this morning because where else can we go? You're the only one that has words of life and hope. And we come with grateful hearts because this day, this morning, is the foundation for everything that we hope and believe in. Your resurrection from the dead. After bearing our sins and paying the price, is what gives us hope and motivation and energy for the days ahead. And Lord, while we live in a world where it's easy to get discouraged by the things going on around us, would you please remind us that we are victorious, that we've already won the battle. It's been won by you. And so help us to live with that hope today. We thank you that the body of Christ is big and it includes a lot of people. And your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, is the one that unites us and draws us together. And while there's a lot of separation in the world, unfortunately, there's a lot of separation in your church. We want to be unified this morning in our worship from different places, from different backgrounds. Lord, would you unify our hearts to worship you this morning? We Pray for those that we know who have needs. We all have loved ones. We all have people that we care about this morning, that we think about, that are heavy on our hearts, that don't know you, that aren't walking with you, that are struggling with various things. And so we want to just take a minute to lift them up to you and ask you to encourage them this morning. And Lord, we pray for those on our prayer list, those who are dealing with physical ailments. So many of them are here today. Evidence of your hand of strength and protection for them. But there's a lot that can't be with us. And so we pray for them, especially those who may be watching this morning, that you would speak to them and lift them up in their spirits. And we commit the Ragsdale family to you, as Lance's mom has come to be with you. And so we're grateful for the fact that she knew you and walked with you. But we pray for them as they grieve, and this week as they celebrate her life. We pray today that you would be honored by our worship, by our giving, by our singing, by the reading and proclaiming of the truths of your word this morning. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before we bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord, I just wanted to mention, I meant to say it during the announcements, but a week ago we prayed for a group of Chinese Christians that were detained in Thailand, and they were seeking asylum, that they were in danger of being returned back to China, where they faced certain torture, imprisonment, who knows what else. Well, praise the Lord, they have gained their freedom and are on their way to Texas. And there's a group of churches in Texas that are going to take them in. And so, praise God, we joined probably a huge chorus of other prayers on their behalf. And the United States State Department stepped up and pressured the Thai government to release them as opposed to send them back to China. So thank you. I know many of you had asked me about it, but I think that news came through Friday. Actually, it was on Good Friday that they got their release. So praise the Lord. Let's bring our tithes and our offerings to the Lord as Kevin O'Brien leads us in worship.
To love a thorn is all the world has. Why did it have to be a heavy cross he was made to bear? And why did they nail his feet and hands? His love would have held him there. It was a cross, for on a cross a thief was supposed to pay. For Jesus had come into the world to steal every heart away. Yes, Jesus had come into this world to steal every heart away.
That the name of Jesus would be lifted high through all the earth, that millions would come to know you today. And Father, we thank you for this time of worship. We can return to you a portion of what you have so richly blessed us with. May it be used to enlarge your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
I want to invite the children to join me up front for our children's sermon. Good morning. Good morning. Come right on down. Here we go. Yeah. Good. Come on. Good to see you. What am I holding here? It's a plant, yes. What do you think this is right here, this little round thing?
An acorn.
An acorn, yes. I knew you'd recognize it. You know that oak trees drop acorns. You knew that, right? And they drop thousands of them, probably millions of them, all over the ground. You always find acorns? He's the acorn man. No wonder he recognized it. He's the acorn man. Well, let me tell you what. The Bible says that when a seed dies in the ground, it doesn't just die, something comes out of it. Like what? The plant. That's right. Do you think this plant would ever grow if this little seed said, I don't want to die. I don't want to go in the ground. No, it wouldn't. The Bible tells us, and it's really talking about Jesus. Because when Jesus died, you see, he was like a seed that went down into the ground. But when he came up out of the grave, he was like the whole plant, you see. And so when a seed, and there are millions of them, and this time of year, let me tell you, there are a lot of seeds dying because there are a lot of plants growing, right? And not every plant, but a lot of plants come out of seeds. You know, what's really neat to me is this seed, you see how it all come, everything came out of that one little crack. You see it right there? Mm-hmm. How did the root know to go down and the leaf know to go up? See that? They came out of the same hole.
Yeah, that's the question.
That is a question. How did it know to do that? Because God made it that way. This is a smart plant. It knows which way is up and which way is down. Isn't that amazing? Yeah.
But it doesn't have a brain.
It does not have a brain. But it's smart because God planted in the seed the knowledge to know how to do that without even thinking. Yeah, seeds don't think. You're right. But I want you to, you know, there are a lot of these out on my lawn, but if you go out, be careful what you pull up, okay? Don't go to your flower bed and do this. But if you see a little thing like this and you pull it up, you'll find maybe an acorn on it. And you can remember that when Jesus died on the cross, they put him in a tomb and they buried him. But he arose again on the third day. And because Jesus rose from the grave, if we trust in him, if we have faith in Jesus, when we die, we too will come to new life and go to heaven and be with him. So every plant reminds us of the resurrection of Jesus. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
And I'm glad you recognize that that, yes, is an acorn. All right, let's pray.
But an acorn
does not have a brain. Thank you. All right, let's pray. Thank you, dear Lord, that acorns can grow into plants even without brains. And they know that the root's supposed to go down and the leaves are supposed to go up. And we thank you, Lord, that when you died and were buried in the tomb, you didn't stay there, but you rose again. And because you rose again, we look forward to heaven with you if we put our faith in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good job. Thank you.
Pick up again in Luke 23, this time in verse 32. Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by watching, for the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Let's stand.
That was slain. Worthy.
It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent." And all the crowds that had assembled for this spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, returned home, beating their breasts. And all his acquaintances and the women who had followed him from Galilee stood at a distance watching these things.
Now there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council, a good and righteous man who had not consented to their decision and action. And he was looking for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down and wrapped it in linen shroud and laid it in a tomb cut in stone, where no one had ever yet been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw the tomb and how his body was laid. And then they returned and prepared spices and ointments.
Mm-hmm.
But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise." And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened.
Oh,
when he was at table with them, the disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread.
Please stand.
I believe it has been all of our experience. It's something we all have in common. Good things happen around the dinner table. Wouldn't you agree with me? Good things happen around the dinner table. We are reminded that it was at the Last Supper that Jesus had some of the most intimate, most significant moments with his disciples prior to his arrest and crucifixion. And the Gospels tell us the story of how he walked with these two guys to Emmaus who did not recognize him until they sat down at the dinner table and he broke the bread and blessed it and their eyes were opened. And then after the resurrection, there was an incident where he appeared to them. And to prove that he was not a ghost, he said, "Let me have something to eat." And while they had some, the Bible tells us, broiled fish Now, I don't know if you like your fish fried or deep fried or whatever, but this was broiled. I mean, very specific. You know what really happened when you get this kind of detail. And he ate it in front of them to prove he was not a ghost. And then finally, one of my favorite was when Jesus cooked breakfast on the seashore. And the disciples were out in the boat. And he told them to throw their nets in one more time. And they caught a big catch of fish. And when they got to shore, the fish was already cooked. Jesus had been doing some fishing, I think. And he served them breakfast on the beach. But he invites us to share at this table. Good things happen at the table. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. Do this to be reminded of who I am. Do this to be reminded of what I have done. Do this to be reminded that my body was broken. Do this to be reminded that my blood was shed for you on the cross. And you know, he promises to be with us personally and intimately in the breaking of the bread and in the sharing of the cup. And it is our delight and our joy to share this table today. Those of you that may be guests among us and haven't done this here in French Camp before, let me remind us all of a few things. First of all, that we do not own this table. It is the Lord's table, and I minister in His name. And we welcome to partake of this feast all who have trusted in Christ, who know Him as their Savior. You do not have to be a member of this church. You need to be a member of the body of Christ. Now, there are surely those among us who perhaps have not trusted in Him. Perhaps some of you are searching, maybe you're inquiring, and we would ask you to simply respectfully and quietly pass the elements by as they come your way. But the Bible also tells us as believers to examine our hearts, to look inwardly and to consider if there is any barrier between us that would stand in the way of this intimate fellowship. And if there is unconfessed sin, if there are outstanding debts of not financial debts, but spiritual debts of offense or sin, we need to settle those things before we come to this table. But dear friends, none of us is worthy of this table. We have all sinned. We all have those debts. But this is the time, this is the place to trust in Him whose shed blood and broken body covers our sins. And so I'm going to pray and allow just a little space for you to pray in the quietness of your own heart and prepare for these elements which we will just now distribute. So let's bow our heads together. Father, we thank you for the giving of your Son, Jesus. Jesus, we thank you that you went willingly to the cross because of your great love for us. Holy Spirit of God, we thank you that you are present with us in this very moment, making real to us the sacrifice of Jesus and applying it to our lives. And so, Father, Son, Spirit, we thank you for your presence in our midst. And so, Lord, would you speak to us in the quietness of our hearts as we prepare them to share in this table. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We are told in the scriptures that on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread that was on the table, and having blessed it, he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." Let me invite the elders to assist me as we distribute these. As you receive the elements, we would invite you to hold them that when everyone is served, we might partake of them together. Our Lord said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take and eat ye all of it." In like manner, he took the cup which was on the table, and having blessed it, he said, "This is my blood. This is the blood of a new covenant." And he shared it with his disciples, even as we share it with you today. The blood of Christ shed for you, take ye all of it. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for a gift so freely given. A gift so true and effective. We thank you for your shed blood and your broken body. Would you take it and revive us, renew us, refresh us, equip us to rise from this place, to love you, to know you, and to serve you better. For we ask in Jesus' name, amen. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit, and he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they were still disbelieving for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you when I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." And he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven, and they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple blessing God.
Let's close out this time of worship together on this beautiful resurrection day as we sing "In Christ Alone."
Solid ground.
Receive now the benediction. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen and amen.